I'm Erin Fleming.
And I'm Taylor Fleming.
We would like to welcome you to the remote worship for Wesley United Methodist Church.
We are so thankful that each and every one of you is here with us today.
Thank you, Fleming family, for that welcome. We really appreciate those that welcome us to worship service. So if you would like to do that, please let us know. I am Brock Warren, the youth director, and I too would like to welcome you for joining us for worship here at Wesley United Methodist Church. And we would love to know that you're worshiping with us. So if you would please, down in the description on YouTube, there's a link to a survey. That is how we are taking our attendance. If you could fill that out, we would greatly appreciate it. You may have also found this survey through an email or on Facebook. You can find it all three of those places, but you only need to fill it out once. But please fill it out each and every Sunday that you are viewing with us. We still have a limited number of yard signs with our theme of comfort and joy for the Advent and Christmas season. So if you are still interested in a yard sign, we invite you to contact the church office. Rosalie will be your contact for that. Please contact her as soon as possible because those are almost gone. As this is the first Sunday in Advent, there will be an Advent wreath lighting later in the service. But if you would like to do that in the coming weeks, we invite you to contact Pastor Tom or Elizabeth in the office and let them know that you would like to be an Advent wreath lighter or reader of the litany, and we would be glad to have you serve in that way. So please let Pastor Tom or Elizabeth in the office know. Today, the Advent study is beginning, and that is our Advent study by Adam Hamilton entitled Incarnation. And if you would like to join that study, it's not too late, so go ahead and reach out and you can still jump in on that study. Those are going to be happening via Zoom on Sundays and on Tuesdays. So let us know, but the Advent study is beginning today. We are planning to have a live nativity on December 20th from 4 to 6, as well as a food drop-off for those in our community that might be having a food need. We will have the food drop off regardless, but we're still hoping to have the live nativity, but please be watching for updates on that activity as it might need to change due to further COVID restrictions. We invite you to light a candle during the prelude, as we would customarily light candles during the worship service. We invite you to do the same. So if you would need to, we invite you to pause to get a candle to light during the prelude so that we might remember being together with each other in the sanctuary and that the Holy Spirit is always with us. So that is why we invite you to light a candle with us. And we also invite you to post on Facebook that you are watching so that everyone knows that we are still the church and still meeting and worshiping together. And then also, if you would please encourage one another to find us on YouTube and worship together. So please let everyone know that you're watching and encourage others to watch along with us. We have two more announcements coming up. Kathy Wright has a special announcement about the angel tree, and Jane Bardsley will have our mission moment. So please stay tuned for that. Thank you for joining us in worship again, and we look forward to seeing you soon.
Good morning, Wesley friends. I hope you all are well and keeping safe. Bert and I want to tell you how much we miss you all, and we're just counting the days until we can all be together and be at church and greet one another. I'm here today to talk to you about our angel tree. This angel tree project is a project that we have done for the last several years for Hope of East Central Illinois. Hope of East Central Illinois is an agency that we have been helping for a number of years in many different capacities. They have been one of the agencies that we have been providing food for since the pandemic started. We now want to provide a gift for the women of these shelters and their children. These women are coming from abusive homes, many times escaping violence, and they leave their houses with nothing but the clothes on their back. These brave women need all the help that they can get. And we here at Wesley want to help provide them with just a little bit of joy that they can have on Christmas morning. The pandemic has made this a bit more challenging this year because we are not in church and you can't pick up your tags. But you can go online to a link that Rosalie has provided for you, and you can look at the list of different tags, sign up for a tag, and then you buy whatever it is that you signed up for, wrap it, and put a tag on it that indicates what's in the gift so that we can match it up with the tag that Hope has provided us. Now, it's going to be a little bit more difficult to get the presents, but we have arranged through Church and Society to have a gift drop-off. And this drop-off will be on Saturday, December 12th from 10 to 2. We're going to run it just like our food drop-off. You have your gifts wrapped and labeled. You pull up on the north side of the church, pop your trunk, and we from Church and Society will grab your gift and take it for you. We hope that we can get all the gifts by then, because then Hope can just come and make one big trip for the gifts. If you are having difficulty signing up, you can call the church office, or you can email Rosalie, or you can call me at 254-3679, and I will do whatever I can to help you so you can complete this project. Today, we light the first candle in Advent, and that candle happens to be hope. And we want to provide hope and joy for these women and children who are in need. Because after all, Jesus is the hope of the world, and he calls each and every one of us to love one another and to provide for the people who are less fortunate. So I hope you will consider participating in this activity. And God bless and keep you safe.
Good morning. I come to you from the missions team this morning to talk about the three areas that we are going to split our Advent money with. We traditionally split it three ways, and we will be doing that again this year. The local one that we have chosen is the Coalition for People in Need. This is only for people who live in the 61920 zip code. They get food vouchers, rent, utilities, occasionally something like gas. Eight churches support this fund, and we are one of them. Our regional giving this year will be to the Midwest Distribution Center. Many of you know that because we do school bags. And we also do money for buckets for cleanup from floods and such. They're doing many things more locally right now, up in including school kids with supplies, people with food, and sometimes durable medical equipment for serious needs. Doctors Without Borders is our chosen group this year for our international. These people are in over 70 countries. They're working diligently to help those with coronavirus and in some places Ebola. They're working to help with the evacuation of and care of immigrants that are going through Greece and being treated horribly. We thank you for your prayers. We thank you for your giving. And we know that you will reach out this Advent season to help others locally, regionally, and around the world.
Thank you.
us turn to the Advent litany on your screen. Let us call upon the name of the Lord. Restore us, O Lord God Almighty. May God's face shine upon us, that we may be saved.
Our scripture for this first Sunday of Advent comes from the prophet Isaiah, the 64th chapter, verses 1 through 9. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountains would quake at your presence, as when fire kindles brushwood and the fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, so that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that we did not expect, you came down, the mountains quaked at your presence. From ages past, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you, who works for those who wait for him. You meet those who gladly do right, those who remember you in your ways. But you were angry, and we sinned. Because you hid yourself, we transgressed. We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us into the hand of our iniquity. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, and you are our potter. We are all the work of your hand. Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord, and do not remember iniquity forever. Now consider, we are all your people.
As we light the Advent candle with hope and desire for the coming of the Lord, let us pray. O God, it seems that the sins of the world are so overwhelming that we feel hopeless, Reignite your faith so that your hope would truly be in you. For you are our only salvation. Amen.
Thank you. please join with me now in the prayer of the day. O God, that we may receive your blessing, touch our brows, touch our heads, and do not look upon us in anger. In a hard year, offer us mercy. In a year of affliction, offer us kindness. Dark spirits banish from us. Bright spirits bring close to us. Gray spirits put away from us. Good spirits draw near to us. When we are afraid, offer us courage. When we are ashamed, be our true face. Be over us like a blanket. Be under us like a bed of furs. Amen.
Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me save that thou art. Thy mind is on by day or by night. When he was sleeping,
responsively. Give ear, O shepherd of Israel, you who lead Joseph like a flock. You who are enthroned upon the cherubim, shine forth. In the presence of Ephraim and Benjamin and Manasseh, stir up your might and come to save us. Restore us, O God, let your face shine that we may be saved. O Lord God of hosts, how long will you be angry with your people's prayers? You have fed them with the bread of tears, and given them tears to drink in full measure. You make us the scorn of our neighbors, and our enemies laugh among themselves. Restore us, O God of hosts, let your face shine, that we may be saved.
I love getting ready for Christmas. The twinkling lights, the memories, the ornaments, the music. The feeling of hope and joy and love and peace, it just feels like home. I wonder if you like Christmas and decorating and getting ready. Today is the first Sunday of Advent. Advent is a time 4 weeks before Christmas where we clean up our homes and our hearts and prepare for the coming of Jesus. We spend time in His Word. We pray. We even light candles to remember God's story. We sing songs that prepare our hearts. And we give because we know that God is the giver of all good gifts. All of Advent helps us draw us nearer to God and to Jesus. And today I want to remind you of a truth that Apostle John tells us in our scripture. Every time we see beautiful shining lights this Advent, let's remember this. Jesus is the light of the world. Jesus said, "Walk in the light before the darkness overtakes you. Whoever walks in the dark does not know where they're going. Believe in the light so that you may become children of light. In him there is life both now and life everlasting. In Jesus, light shines in the darkness, and darkness cannot win. Darkness cannot overcome the light. We are beloved children of the light, a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own. May we sing loud today the praises of God who calls us out of darkness and into his wonderful light."
Hear these words with me from the first letter from St. Paul to the church at Corinth, the first chapter, beginning with the third verse. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to my God always for you, because of the grace of God that has been given to you in Christ Jesus. For in every way you have been enriched in him, in speech and knowledge of every kind, just as the testimony of Christ has been strengthened among you, so that you are not lacking in any spiritual gift as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ. He will also strengthen you to the end, so that you may be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful. By him you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. In her book, Opening the Scriptures, Faith Through the Year, Margaret Hebblethwaite says this. She writes, "I have a friend who says that Advent is his favorite season. Why? I think because Advent is a time of exquisite balance between the sadness of the mess we live in and the bliss of the world we would like to live in. Advent is when we acknowledge that bliss is not the blotting out of pain with port and plum pudding, but a process, a pilgrimage, a pregnancy, and amidst the chaos of the world's governing, a cry for the coming of the reign of God." In a recent article published in the Christian Century, Richard Lisher notes that we are grieving this Advent, which is not like us this close to Christmas. And he's right, if you ask me. We are grieving. We're grieving sickness, and we're grieving death, and we're grieving the kind of life we knew pre-pandemic. We're grieving the season of too much busyness turned to the season of too little busyness, and grieving the kind of Christmas we would like to have but may not have. In churchy preachery talk, Advent is a season of waiting, something we're not typically fond of doing this time of year, or maybe ever. In the case of 2020, which stands every chance of going on record as the most despised year of our lives, it feels like we've already been waiting. The last 9 months have been one unbearably long wait, in fact, so that today is not so much the 29th of November or the first Sunday of Advent, but rather the 812th day of March. A month which, by the way, has been characterized by somebody as God's way of explaining to people who have never been drunk what a hangover feels like. If anything, Advent just gives it a name. For those of us who prefer to proceed from Thanksgiving dinner full speed into joy to the world, the scriptures and the words and the songs and the tone of Advent may feel like an all-out effort to put the kiboshes on our Christmas cheer. How dare you, preacher? But maybe Advent means more this time, this year. Maybe the words and the scriptures and the hymns ring truer this time, this year. Maybe the fact that only one candle glows today and not all four reflects our collective mood of yearning and absence and longing. Season opens like our worship does today with the prophet screaming at God. At least it sounds like screaming to me. More than it typically does, actually. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down. The text is a portion of a communal lament, and we'll say more about laments and lamenting in a bit, but it's a portion of a communal lament that begins with the seventh verse of chapter 63 and ends just three verses beyond today's text with the 12th verse of chapter 64. The sentiment moves from the more restrained request, look down in chapter 63, verse 15, to the more full-throated, come down in today's text. I've never been really sure exactly what I think or how I feel about those billboards. You might have seen them. They bear the message, don't you make me come down there. And on the signature line, of course, God's name, God. Well, it's backward in this case. God is put on notice that we are looking for an appearance. The context is that the Hebrew people have returned from exile in Babylon. A while back in a devotional video, Pastor Janice reminded us of Israel's time in exile and compared that time to our experience of the pandemic we're living in. In the case of the Israelites, their exile has ended and they've returned to their homeland, only their temple is in ruins and its rebuilding is in the hands of foreign nations that know nothing about their religion or their God. In other words, they thought their long night was over, but it wasn't. And Isaiah's words are fodder for a typical Advent sermon. You meet those who gladly do right, those who remember you in your ways. But you were angry and we sinned. Because you hid yourself, we transgressed. We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us into the hand of our iniquity. And with that, the Advent preacher is fired up and ready to go, stealing your Christmas joy at the earliest opportunity. But this is no typical Advent. Tempting as it might be for even a mild-mannered, progressive-leaning preacher like me to interrupt the beginning of your holiday joy by calling out some of our own plenteous sin, I find it all but impossible to go there. Hungry as we might typically be for a theological conversation on the relationship between God's anger and the Hebrew people's sin, or ours for that matter, or that same anger and God's propensity to hide, this is no typical Advent. Dr. Lisher is right We are grieving this Advent. We're grieving because of sickness and death and disconnection and loneliness and isolation and fear and anxiety and worry and political turmoil and anger and uncertainty and changes of plans and changes in work and changes in church. And after all, by the way, Pastor, didn't I read or hear or see someplace that our theme was comfort and joy? Just exactly when can we expect that to be delivered? Well, it's coming. But first I must confess, one of my first reactions to Isaiah upon reading it in preparation for today was, this sounds like the cry of somebody who's depressed. Someone who's looking for something that's been lost. Somebody who feels abandoned by God. Someone living on the doorstep of the longest, darkest night of the year, or maybe of the world. Isaiah bears a strong and striking resemblance to the psalmist whose words we have made our words in worship today. O Lord God of hosts, how long will you be angry with your people's prayers? You have fed them with the bread of tears and given them tears to drink in full measure. Restore us, O God of hosts. Let your face shine that we may be saved. To quote Richard Lisher again, today, especially today, we don't pine for a second coming that will bring the world to an end. We pray for the indwelling of Christ that will enable the world to continue. Comfort and joy, right? But first, lament. Advent allows us to do what is strikingly absent in most all of our worship, and that is to lament. Dennis T. Olson, professor of Old Testament at Princeton Theological Seminary, defines a lament in this way. He says, a lament is a prayer to God for help in time of need. The petitioner offers reasons why God should intervene and remedy the situation. Lament is disputation, an argument with God. It may be that the lament will change God's mind and reverse God's plans, as Moses did on Mount Sinai after the golden calf. The one making the lament is certainly not guaranteed the desired result. But the faithful petitioner is guaranteed a hearing, a listening. Israel's God is a God who pays special attention to the cry of the oppressed. So you and I have plenty of reasons to lament. We have been living already in one unbearably long Advent. And we're grieving. In a culture shaped by happiness-seeking and consumer-driven religion and continually upbeat church, lament can feel like something we ought neither want nor need to do. Who needs to lament? But that seems to our detriment. I cannot help but wonder if some of our angry words and our bickering with one another and our name calling and our tendency to do harm to one another is reflective of our failure simply to lament, to scream, to cry out, to let it out, to boldly argue with God. If I can learn anything from Isaiah in Advent 2020, it is that there is in fact trouble so deep that God is the only real answer. If I can bridge the gap between post-exilic Israel and you and me on the 812th day of March in the year of our Lord 2020, it's by noting that we are not the only ones ever to have suffered. that this waiting, this yearning, this longing, this lamenting of ours is not an aberration, it's not a mistake, but rather a deep part of God's story. And only by saying that that is so, only by confessing this truth, can we really open ourselves to the comfort and joy promised by the one who is coming to us. Let us pray. Stir up your might and come to save us. Restore us, O God. Let your face shine that we may be saved. We come at the beginning of Advent, but God, we feel like we come in the middle of the longest Advent, the longest waiting and yearning and fearing and hoping and crying and screaming and sighing. We, your people, remember, God, we are your people. You are our God, our potter. Have mercy on us. Blessed God, we're overwhelmed and weary and tired from all that is changing us, changing the world, all that is afflicting us, sickness and death and politics and people and struggle and pain and disaster. Open up the heavens. Stir up your might, God. Come to save us. Restore us. Let your face shine that we may be saved. Have mercy on us. Have mercy on this world you love. Have mercy on this nation and all the nations of the world. Have mercy on our leaders. Have mercy on those who have no voice and no choice. Have mercy on those who are marginalized. Have mercy on us when we are tired and we are sad and we are worried and we are troubled and we are uncertain and when we're angry and when we want to give up. We need comfort and we need joy. Stir up your might and come to save us. Restore us, O God. Let your face shine that we may be saved. In the name of the one who teaches us to pray, as we pray boldly together, saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, as we come to this time of offering in our service, I do want to thank you from the bottom of my heart for your faithful giving in this time and season. Particularly, I want to say thank you. I hope that you will see by looking at your newsletter and other Wesley communications that we've done a good job in response to our need to bridge the gap between where we have been financially and where you brought us because of your faithfulness. We've done a good job of catching up, as it were, and I thank you for that, and I anticipate that you'll continue to be faithful and generous in all the ways that you can through the end of the year. To put it in accounting terms, so that we'll end the year in the black. But those are simply a way, those words, of saying that if we are distracted by financial issues, that means we're distracted from our ministry and our mission, and we don't want to be that way. And so I want to thank you that you're working toward the goal of not being distracted in that way. And I am so grateful for all that you're doing by way of your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness. And at this time, I want us to take a few moments to look at a video that will show us, tell us about the exciting work of the Wesley Green Team this year. And parts of it, I hope they'll give you warm thoughts of summer days on a winter day. Let's take a look at that.
Hi, we are pleased to talk about the Wesley Green Team for this ministry moment today. Members Jane Bardsley, Karen Klausing, Stephanie Corum, Sherry Hawker, Robin Murray, and Rich Wandling grew our Green Team to serve the missions of Wesley's Church and Society Work Group and Illinois' Faith in Place, a group that empowers Illinois people of all faiths to care for the earth. The Church and Society Work Group facilitated our Green Team by hosting a screening of National Geographic's From Paris to Pittsburgh with Faith in Place. This documentary highlighted the good work churches and other organizations around the country are doing to combat climate change and other environmental problems. The film screening brought us together and helped us build a team. Faith in Place regional leader Cindy Shepherd also provided guidance and many resources to buttress our goals for the church and wider community. For our first big project, we decided to address the recycling needs we saw around us. With help from Karen Klausing, who designed our logo and created recycling guides, we initiated the Green Team with the celebration of a Green New Year on January 5th. To make it easier for members of our church to reduce, reuse, and recycle this year, we shared a reusable shopping bag with our awesome logo and handy recycling guide at the end of each church service. We also provided recycling bins for the kitchen and worked with volunteers to reduce waste in helpful ways. When COVID hit, we were working out further recycling ventures, exploring the benefits of an energy audit, and planning both a service fair table and an Earth Day event. Because of the stay-in-place orders, we moved outside, proposing and beginning work on a church garden on Wesley's grounds. We started with a single 4x8 bed built by the Corums and two round grow bags donated by Robin Murray. Our small garden was tended this summer by the Green Team, and produce was distributed to church members and Standing Stone Food Pantry. With help from Alex Pearson, a soon-to-be Eagle Scout, our little garden is growing. We invite all of you to join us in the spring and hope many of you will host a garden bed as we share excellent local food with our church and wider community. We also invite any green-minded folks to join our team. Here are a few images from our planting that Pastor Tom shared with us. Thank you for supporting the work we do as God's faithful stewards of the earth.
Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them springing fresh from the world. Sweet the rain's new fall, sunlit from heaven, like the first dew fall on the first grass. praise for the sweetness of the red garden sprung in completeness where his feet pass. Mine is the sunlight, mine is the morning, born of the one light, Eden saw play.
Please join me in the prayer of dedication. Gracious God, we give our best to you, not out of guilt or fear, but with gratitude and faith. You have been our support in times of need. Every breath we take is a gift from you. We would be awake and watchful for opportunities to make a difference, to help others be alert for your presence, to value life in all its fullness, and to learn to care. We dedicate these symbols of thankfulness and all the days of our lives to those purposes. Amen.
Promised one.
May God our Maker bless you and keep you. May Jesus Christ be the one light that is your comfort and joy, even in your lamenting and your anguish. And may the Holy Spirit shine the light of God's face upon all of us, that we may be saved. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.